This is the DLR Cast, the essential podcast for fans of Diamond David Lee Roth. All right, folks. Once again, welcome to the DLR Cast, the only podcast by and for fans of the mighty Diamond One, David Lee Roth. Recording, you might not be hearing this on Labor Day, but we're recording on Labor Day, and it's never a labor when I'm talking to my good friend and partner in crime here, Darren Paltrowitz, on the DLR Cast. How are you doing, sir?
Non-damn stop. Man, that last episode we said, yeah, and we don't know, Dave might put out a new thing in 24 hours, and he did again.
Which is the second time that happened, so.
I think that there's more than meets the eye on that one, but that happened, and then about 48 hours later, we see Wolfgang in top form. So it goes from being a, Steve, do we have enough content for an episode, to a, damn it, Steve. Oh, too much.
Yeah, and I guess let's start with Dave's song. Dave posted another song, not a new original David Lee Roth song, but a re-recorded version of Panama with his current band. And where this gets super interesting is that the official announcement from Dave Central, the Mojo Dojo, saying that it was one of 14 songs recorded in 2 hours in May of 2022. So a couple things we saw right when this posted, all the guys in the band, and you can, Al Estrada,
Brian Wheeler, Francis Valentino.
Thank you. There you go. On guitar, bass, drums and bass respectively.
Yeah.
And so we saw those guys posting on Instagram. So that about right when the song came out, that's them on it basically. And that it was fun to do or whatever. So, okay, well, there's some blessing right there. And those posts weren't taken down. Right. And then later on, we see the official announcement from Dave HQ, the Mojo Dojo, like I just mentioned, saying it was a bunch of tracks that we record. So it was all Van Halen songs, apparently, yes. apparently, which gives me some puzzlement right there. But I've long lamented here about Dave, you know, basically forgetting the bulk of his solo material for the bulk of his solo career and or not paying any sort of, you know, mind or tribute to it for the most part.
Yeah.
But the fact that it was recorded, I guess, first off, what do you think of it? I think Dave sounds really good. I'm not going to quibble over the mix and the drums and all that. I think Al Estrada is absolutely smoking. And overall, I mean, I don't understand necessarily why this happened. I know you have some theories.
I do.
But overall, I dig it. And I think Dave sounds really good, considering we've all been speculating for the last 6 months that he's got health problems and we're never going to hear him sing again. And we've also been wondering, and this falls in this timeline, what he was doing down in Mexico, where we think there was a private show done.
There was definitely a private show done in late May. And these were sessions that were done in May. In Dave's, I've worked to confirm a lot of details on this. Like, it was posted Thursday night, pretty late night. And my source just texted me at night and goes, here you go. And I went, oh, what? Wait, what? And I realized, oh, do you remember back in May when some of the people in Dave's band did Instagram stories that disappeared really quickly with their gear endorsements in it?
Yes, even quicker than Instagram stories normally does it, within 24 hours.
Exactly. Yeah, that was this. And at the time, I was told that these were just reference. I'm doing air quotes for those who are just hearing this. Air quote reference material. And that's what that is. What I've since been told is he wanted to record the Vegas set that this band planned on doing. So this was the lineup that was going to do the Vegas residency. And the show in Vegas was supposed to be just pretty much early Van Halen. It's debatable if they were going to do just the Gigolo and just like Paradise. Because wasn't the Sammy Dave tour in 2002? Didn't he skip just like Paradise and just the Gigolo? It was just pretty much the first two albums of Van Halen with a couple other hits.
Pretty much with Jump and Panama. And I remember being disappointed over the lack of DLR solo music, but there was at least, I'm pretty sure if he didn't do Just a Gigolo, God, what else did he do? Did he do Yankee Rose?
On that tour. But this, people have told me that this tour was just going to be a, hey, this is classic Van Halen. That's what the Vegas residency was going to be. And so I believe, due to reliable people, that that is what they tracked in the studio. But I, you know, but before I get your feedback on it, two things. Dave said, hey, we did 14 songs in 2 hours. I verified that that is correct. Based on my DLR band album conspiracy theories about, oh, we tracked it in 10 days. Really? With three different guitars? Really? 10 days, Dave. Okay, we believe you. That part is true, but I have heard from a listener or two on this that maybe the vocals were fixed in post. I'll put it to you that way.
Yeah, I mean, listen, you do a couple punch-ins, you do a couple fixes here and there. I mean, nobody's perfect, and that's why you go in the studio. It's not live, right? I mean, if you go back in and fix what maybe some obvious mistakes or what may be bugging you, maybe you stumbled over a word or two, doesn't matter who you are, everybody does that and probably should do that, unless you just go, fuck it, we're just going to put this all out as live in Japan. Live from the Tokyo Dome.
Exactly, except that Dave's statement about this was that there was no overdubs and no tracks.
Right.
So, that it's live. And so I take issue with that. When you're going to claim that something's live and it's not live fully, I believe that the trio backing Dave, Al, Ryan, and Francis, who were solid as ever, who had to do their blocks, the 75 rehearsals that Dave was not at.
Clearly, they're all very well rehearsed. We know this.
Well rehearsed as well rehearsed can be. But, you know, I think he sounds great. I think it sounds awesome. The tones are off. I know that some of the people involved in it, their feedback on the tones and the sounds in the mix was not approved by Dave. And
what do you mean, like the guitar tone and overall vibe? Okay.
Those are not the drum, guitar, and mix sounds that the band members necessarily wanted to hear. So this was a Dave joint.
Interesting. I just... a couple things. I'm disappointed to know that what would have been the Vegas residency would have been primarily all the first two, basically all Van Halen, Dave solo free, right? With the exception of maybe, I would bet you, well, who knows what it could have been, but I've always, for one, just the fact, been disappointed with the fact that he's forsaken so much of basically most of his solo career. Yeah. And I've said before that if I think it would have been amazing, given how the way his tastes run, if you did a solo show that was part Mambo Slammers, part Van Halen cover, part, I mean, just really backup singers, do all this stuff that he's only touched on a lot of times in his solo career. And so I've recorded as far as solo albums. But it's just that, again, as usual, you have to ask the timing of it. Why now? Why all of a sudden now? Why was it recorded in May? Does this have anything to do with that Mexico concert? I'm assuming those were the guys who went down to play this Mexico concert.
That is the same band that went down to Mexico, to Cabo at a resort.
Is it? Obviously, we know Dave loves to record virtually everything, but it's just, I guess, what the game plan is for posterity, obviously, but then also just to release Panama. Will there be any other songs? You've kind of had this run of releasing, what, 5 songs from the John 5 sessions, and all of a sudden I throw this out here on a random, what was it, Thursday?
Well, I think I figured out why, but that's gonna step on you talking about Wolfgang and the Foo Fighters show.
Okay, well, this is my conspiracy theory, and let it be known that we have not spoken about this since the last time we were off mic. My thought is, I'm wondering if this was sort of just some sort of weird, I guess for lack of a better word, ridiculous or immature way to steal a little thunder from the fact that Wolfgang was going up and doing in London in Wembley Stadium at the Taylor Hawkins Taylor Hawkins tribute concert, doing On Fire and Hot for Teacher. Which, first off, let me just put a full-throated mea culpa here on my part, because I said loudly on many occasions that you will never hear Wolfgang do a Van Halen song in concert. And I have a mea culpa there, because we heard him do 2 of them and heard him do it flawlessly.
Flawlessly.
He sounded incredible. I mean, it just, genetics, I don't care, talent, pure talent, that was just amazing. And so I did not qualify my stance that, well, maybe for a tribute concert, you'll never hear him. I still don't think you'll ever hear him do a Van Halen show in a song in any Mammoth shows. But yes, I was wrong. I was 100% wrong as far as him ever doing a Van Halen song live fully. But so I'm wondering if that had anything to do with it, which is kind of ridiculous. Why even bother doing, why, if that's your reason, it just strikes me as just one of those cringe sort of, fuck, what's the point of that moments?
Well, if I can get conspiracy theory on it, and again, Wolfgang was incredible. Justin Hawkins from The Darkness, who's been a favorite of mine for a long time.
I love The Darkness. I love him. He's hilarious.
Oh, his YouTube series is fantastic. And he has a great video where he defends David Lee Roth's Vegas residency from probably 9 months or so ago. That's great. You could tell he is a fan of music and a lot of the bands that we like. But I was thinking about this. Okay. You also a music industry veteran of sorts here. So, Steve, when a television show is going to be broadcast globally, do they have to clear the music rights on what is going to be played?
I'm assuming yes. I mean,
yes.
Yeah, you did. Oh, for broadcast. I'm saying a live, straight up live stream. Yeah, for broadcast, absolutely.
Okay. Did they just decide that the Taylor Hawkins concert was going to be broadcast that day, or is that pre-planned through Paramount having U.S. or at least North American broadcast rights, that it was going to be broadcast on that and CBS was going to broadcast a 1 hour special?
Oh, this was probably inked 3 months ago, for goodness sakes, at least.
Okay, so something like that happens, you have to clear the publishing on every single song. Did the Wolfgang version of Hot for Teacher get shown on the CBS 1 hour broadcast?
I did not see the CBS 1 hour broadcast. Yes, I'm assuming it did.
Yes.
Yes.
Mr. David Lee Roth was aware that they were clearing the music rights for Van Halen songs. So I'm going to go there on that one. Now, David Lee Roth, in terms of all the new recordings he's put up over the last 2.5 years, wouldn't just go on YouTube. They would also go on Spotify, all the Apple, all the digital.
Right, all the digital outlets, sure.
Panama is not on Spotify and Apple and all that. The last time I checked, it's just on YouTube. Why is that? Because usually it's a 24-hour window or so for the thing to come up. This was a preemptive strike by Dave to go, hey, I can still do this. That is my take on it. You don't have to fully agree on that. Otherwise, how do you justify he recorded it in May and then it just goes up September 1st, I think, on a Thursday night at 9 o'clock at night on YouTube?
I got to tell you, that was the first thing I thought of, was the timing of this, where it comes about right on top of the tribute concert. And I just don't, you're right. It's from what I can tell, it's not on Spotify anywhere. And I bet you don't see it anywhere, ever see it on there or any of the other services. If that's the case, that was the first thing I wondered. And if that's the case, it's just kind of bums me out.
But wait, there's more.
Not
ruining anyone's day here, but our friends at Van Halen News Desk were the ones who basically broke all the story details on this, because when you want to get the story on what happened with Dave, you reach out to his handler, Jerry Leonard, his accountant and his manager, who's in the background of that Mexico City video where he's being accosted by the paparazzi at LAX.
Right.
You see Jerry in the background there.
Aha.
Yeah, and Jerry is a she. Somebody once identified Jerry as a he. Jerry is a she. When you want the comment, you go to Jerry. Jerry goes to Dave. Dave gives you something, and then Jerry massages it towards the presentable way. Van Halen News Desk had to go to Jerry on this, and I'm going to say it was about 18 hours before Van Halen News Desk had this posted, meaning they didn't have a prepared statement. This was not a well-thought in advance release. This was a, oh, crap, Dave, what do we got scenario.
Man, this is stuff that drives me crazy. I got to tell you, because it's just, it's so, again, I bring up, what's the point? Why? I can't believe you're at 68 years old, 69 years old. That's your motivation for doing something like this, considering the reason why Wolfgang was doing that to begin with. You get what I'm saying? Why would you ever, it just strikes me, if that's the reason, and I don't want to believe it is, or maybe if there's some sort of, maybe it's not so much of a show me, maybe it's, well, it's still kind of the same thing. It's like, well, there's going to be all this search engine traffic for Van Halen. How do I take advantage of it?
Well, let's piggyback on it. Do you remember the coincidence that the Eddie Van Halen Rolling Stone story was predated about 2 days by Deep Throat Dave on the Unchained podcast?
That was not a coincidence, was it?
No. So when we hear that David Lee Roth is well calculated in all of his moves, now do you get how it's not just conspiracy theories? It's not just coincidences. It's, there's serious chess being played.
I was just going to say, what's that analogy? You know, some people are playing checkers. It's chess. Yeah. It's two moves ahead. It's usually two or three confusing sideways moves that just only make sense to maybe the people who are deciding those moves, I think.
Yeah, he's not playing checkers. He's playing chess. And wow. Unless I'm wrong. Hey, Dave, prove me wrong. Make a public statement that says that I/we are wrong. Sue Steve for libel, not me, by the way.
I got nothing. You can have my mic.
I look at all this. I've asked my inside sources. Like, so remember my crazy Disco Dave theory that he has the side band that just does the covers? And that might be partially true. They said that he has in the past couple of years done original material. It's just he doesn't finish it per se. Everything that Dave seems to have done in the last 5 to 10 years is, you know what I feel like doing right now? And he does it and he pays everybody and then he kind of sits on it. So he is not retired. That one I am entirely.
No, there's retired is him not doing anything, him not being creative, have some sort of odd, you know, odd or not so odd outlet. Sorry, that guy will be active until the day he can't no longer be active. I guess the positives to this is I'm glad he's still singing.
Yeah.
For a guy with, quote unquote, all these health problems that are bandied about and rumored about, he sure looked great at LAX. He sure sounds good in this. You can't do those kind of vocals from a freaking wheelchair. You know what I mean? I mean, the fact that doing all that in 2 hours, if that's the case, let's say he did a few overdubs, but if he's singing and that's straight to tape for the most part, right?
Yeah.
And that's a lot of work, 14 hours worth of singing there. And I know if you get into the comments, and I'm not much of a musician, to say, oh, his pitch is all over the place, whatever. I'm not sure if they tuned down a half step or whatever it is. And maybe someone can tweet at us and tell us, let's get into some more musician things. I think the drum sound aside, which just sounds kind of flat and just,
the performance is excellent for the record.
Performances are excellent.
The mix is garbage.
The mix, yeah. Well, but that's the weird thing also. If you're going to do this, okay, and you have the money to do it, and it was recorded in May, you certainly had the time to mix it properly before you put it out, assuming, right? Why wouldn't you? The fact that this was not decided on a Wednesday to put this out on a Thursday, right, means there was some pre-planning. So it's like, okay, well, if we're only going to put it on YouTube, I'm not exactly sure. I mean, because of publishing, there's some sort of publishing involved with YouTube. Why can he put it out on YouTube and not? I'd love to have somebody who's really well-versed, and it's always been somewhat confusing to me, really well-versed on as far as royalties and mechanical royalties, publishing, all that stuff, sync rights, all that sort of thing.
A lot of that stuff. I'd say I'm state-of-the-art 2015 or 2016 on all that. And a lot has changed in terms of blanket deals. The Van Halen publishing catalog used to be a four-way split, depending on whether it was Roth or Hagar before they froze out Michael Anthony, under Warner Chappell. And then one by one, I think Eddie went to a startup publishing company, and then maybe he came back and forth and did split catalogs. There's complex math going on, but dealings that I've had with YouTube are a lot of it is pre-cleared. When you have outside writers, that's when it gets a little murky, or they say, well, we're Warner Chappell for the world except Europe. Then it gets a little murky. But well, it's not like that.
What I'm worried about is if you have the rights to put it, to release something on YouTube, why can't you do it at Spotify or Amazon? Well, unless maybe because he didn't want to.
It's that it does not immediately go up. If you're using something like TuneCore or DistroKid, if I've gone way too into the weeds of that, do you know what I'm talking about? Or should
I know. Yeah.
Well, for those less familiar, those services, you basically upload your music through them. It's a portal subscription-based thing. And then within 24, 48 hours, it goes up onto Apple, Spotify, et cetera. You choose the territories.
It's a distribution platform.
And if you're not on a major label, you're probably using one of those services or the Orchard, one of those to do it. I would believe that Wah Was That, 2! Records, even though, as we talked about, the trademark on Wah Was That has expired, but it still is, whatever that is. Dave's got some paperwork problems. That's the nicest way I'm going to put it.
Well, there's in the notes to the video on YouTube, there's nothing there. Nothing says what was that, no copyright date, nothing that it just is. Yeah. It just has his social media handles and website address. That's it.
Yeah, it's sloppy. It's if you were worth what David Lee Roth was worth, you'd probably go, this is my lawyer. They handle all the legal stuff. This is my accountant. They do all the accountant stuff. This is my butcher. They handle all of my meat. But unfortunately, he doesn't operate like that. There's a few different lawyers at hand. There might be more than one accountant besides his accountant manager. Either that or he's just been firing people every 2-3 years. Now, because he has a split catalog, he's not able to do everything under one umbrella. Whereas somebody like David Bowie, he would have a reversion deal and he would be like, I'm leaving Warner Brothers. I'm taking this with me. Now everything forward is with Sony. So everything's in one place. Everything gets done at the same time. Well, Dave has the Van Halen stuff. Then he has the solo stuff initially, which is Warner Brothers. Then he leaves Sony. Then he leaves Warner Brothers and some of it is with him. Then he goes back to Van Halen a tiny bit, and some of that is Warner Brothers, and some of that's Interscope. So in other words, he doesn't have one way of clicking one button, and everything gets done with the same template. That's a really long-winded way to say he's complex.
Well, what I was thinking about this early this morning, as a matter of fact, as a new Ozzy Osbourne track dropped from his forthcoming album, a song called Nothing Feels Right, kind of a ballady sort of song, but heavy, with Zakk Wylde. And I love it. I love everything I've heard from this new Ozzy record, which I can't say the same from the last Ozzy record, because he did there was a song with Post Malone, which probably is, that's all I need to say there. And I love Ozzy's later period solo stuff. I mean, there's people who say, well, he hasn't really done much since, I don't like any album since No More Tears, whatever. And he went back to Black Sabbath, all stuff. He's had some great guitar players and some really killer stuff. And so, you know, he's, for the last 4 months or so, there's been a series of videos leading up to, I think the album actually comes out next week or this coming week, I believe, Friday.
It's part of NFL Super Bowl. I'm sorry, some NFL Rams game pre-show, post-show.
Yeah. Thing. I mean, it's Ozzy, it's Sharon Osbourne. The marketing is going to be great. They know how to reach those fans.
Yeah.
And it gets us talking, gets other people talking. But I think about this a lot. And I wish there was some sort of discipline and some sort of way to corral, almost from an A&R standpoint, Dave's releases. And I wish it was me. What I'm getting at is that the way these songs have dribbled out with no details or nothing. I mean, when you want, clearly you want people to hear this stuff. Yeah. All right. So that's why you put it out there. But if you want as many people as possible to hear this stuff, you have to do a bit more than just throw it out there. And then that's it. Do you get what I'm saying?
That's it.
And I wish there was some sort of strategy to the new music. Like, for instance, I don't know, let's point everything into, say, pick a month and say, this month we're going to put out each week these 5 cover songs. that we know are out there, right? We're going to do we're going to do the version of Baker Street, and you gear all that up, and you get all the publishing straight, and you get all the rights ready, and you have everything mixed and mastered, and you look on the calendar and you go, 6 months from now, this is what we're doing. And you have somebody that can corral all this shit and put it together. And I'm not saying it has to be a physical release, but what you do something cool where it's like, you know what, Dave, do some artwork specific for each of these things. I mean, you can make some good coin, I think. Let's put some CDs together or something in his garage, 45 singles. I don't fucking know. But what I'm saying is, even from a digital online standpoint, some sort of strategy to corral it, to put it out there and go, all right, now's the time. Over the next year, let's put out these songs that we did with John Five. What's our strategy here? What do we do with this thing? What's the order? What songs we want to put in? Do we want to do, a couple videos for it? That sort of thing. Instead, we get Panama with some old photo that we first saw in Crazy from the Heat or whatever in the book. And you go, huh? And sure, it gets us talking, but no one's going to talk about it in a week from now. And then you don't know what the hell's going to come up next.
I don't think anybody is talking about it. And I say that because, hey, dumbass, you released a single Labor Day weekend. Who is looking for new music Labor Day weekend? Where are they doing radio ads Labor Day weekend?
You pick who's listening to radio anymore?
Terrestrial radio station is doing like our Labor Day rock countdown weekend.
But still, I mean, look, Ozzy put out a song today. I mean, you don't have to go. I mean, it's that. But there's been 3 months worth of buildup to this new album. First, it was a track with Jeff Beck. Then there's a song with Tony Iommi. And so it's, you've known about this. There's been some advance. And I haven't dug deep to look at the statistics, but it came out September 1st. It's on YouTube. It's got 81,000 views. So it's not even in six figures yet. But I guess it's a partial victory, the fact that there was some sort of announcement from Dave's camp saying this is where it came from. So I guess let's just be happy with that for now.
There's only an announcement because the Van Halen news desk people reached out and they did not get an answer in 5 minutes. I hope I'm not pulling the curtain back right away. They did not post the full statement of what they got. That was edited down too. I hope that Jeff from Van Halen News Desk one day can be like, okay, guys, this is what it's really like. And this is the stuff I had to edit out to get what you're seeing, because it's not like they just said, here you go. Everybody's kind of editing for Dave. And you wonder like how such a smart guy can make the worst decisions over and over and over again. Nice. Here's why I say that. David Lee Roth was state of the art in the 80s. He was state of the art at different points in the 90s. Like, he put out a single through his website in 1997, an internet single in 1997. So he either had the smartest people working for him, or he was just forward thinking beyond belief. Into the 2000s, he still did a lot of innovative stuff. I would say his radio show with K-Rock, his ill-fated radio show, was like podcasting before podcasting in a way. He always took chances. And then the last like 9 years, it's been like, so he's doing not only the opposite of what he's been doing, supposed to be doing, but like, why?
Let's not forget, this is an organization that lost the DavidLeeRoth.com domain name for a number of years.
Yeah. One of the things I have to figure out if we can still use it for this podcast, but is how he didn't have David Lee Roth on Instagram and they had to buy that from Ronnie from the band The Muffs, because he's such a big Van Halen fan. He claimed at David Lee Roth. So if you go back to a certain point, I think the first post on David Lee Roth Instagram, the comments are like, where's Ronnie? Where's Ronnie? Where's Ronnie?
I feel like we're bitching too much and dissing too much and but again, we, as we say, we're fans, we're not fanboys, and as fans, and we see this all the time with Kiss fans, of which I'm one of them, and you see that with hardcore fans, these things, it's not about protecting the status quo. It's just, I think it's more about just the frustration of what could be, what and why it isn't. Do you know? I mean, I think that's why it puzzles so many fans. And there's plenty of reasons why. Listen, for all the people who are still upset about the fact that there's no Van Halen tribute, well, you know what? They'd rise above all the bullshit rumor mills and everything else and whoever is in it or not in it. You know what has stuck out to me the most is when Michael said, and it was almost, he didn't even go into that much detail, but in one of the interviews, Michael said, Alex has been grieving a lot. You know what? I bet that was possibly the biggest holdup. For all we know, it could have got into details, and Alex got a little bit into it. Went, you know what? This is too fucking hard for me, hard on me right now. I can't do this right now. I don't want to play with anybody else but Eddie. And I just, this is just, you don't know. And you know what? That's fine if it is. I mean, the fact that everybody all went to, and again, Wolfgang, I think maybe fed into this a little bit, but I think there's so much we don't know, and it's not always all Dave's fault. Having said all that, there's a lot of things that can be done a lot better when it comes from strictly Dave organizationally. But it also falls from the fact that for years, I mean, VanHalen.com and the Van Halen camp at the label was the last place you went for news about stuff or what was going on with the band. Is there a new album coming out? Or is this even as when, I mean, I look back on it and the fact that they did a lot of press and a lot of advanced stuff and a lot of marketing around those records with Sammy and then also with Van Halen 3, yeah. Right? They did TV appearance. They did things. And then, of course, I understand, and I think it was really smart when Irving Azoff came over and the reunion tour happened because you know what? There was so much mystery involved with it. And the fact that between that and different kind of truth that there was a virtual lockdown on press and stuff, it actually worked to that advantage, I think. But now we're way beyond that.
Now we're way beyond that. And to clarify that, I'm not all negative all the time.
You're not. Yes. Not at all. What's that?
Kiss. And with Kiss, it's easy to get on Kiss's case because the lip syncing rumors, the way that Gene and Paul handle Tommy and Eric, those are negative things that you can think about Kiss. But at the same time, Kiss just announced a Creatures of the Night deluxe box set that's really cool.
I've been following that for a while. I think one of the guys on Three Sides of a Coin is involved in putting that together in that podcast. And I mean, I just saw a big photo of it, an announcement for it, and it just looks amazing.
It does.
It really does.
We've been getting some interesting soundboard live.
Yes, they've been. Here's the deal. You know what it's about? It's about taking active care and proactive care and forward thinking about the legacy and what you're putting out in front of consumers.
Yeah.
So what you're giving to fans. Sure, it's going to make money. And that's 1A as far as the things that you want to accomplish. But right with that is putting out something that's quality, that isn't going to diminish, that is something that fans want. I mean, if they were to put out yet another greatest hits, Kiss, you go, really? Now we're going to do an end of the road greatest hits album?
Yeah.
You wanted the best part four, whatever it was. They've milked that to death. The fact that they're putting out these soundboard recordings, these things, is so freaking cool. And now this Creatures of the Night box set. I'm hoping someone does an Asylum box set. Nobody will, but I can dream.
I think eventually that'll happen. And we did see some Guns N' Roses box set stuff happen. Stuff that we had not heard from the Appetite for Destruction era of the band. Def Leppard has not stopped putting out stuff. Motley Crue has the smallest recorded output for any legendary band, in my opinion. Like, Joy Division and Motley Crue are about the same level, and the difference is Joy Division was around 3 years. And they were
as far as the amount of music?
Pretty much. Joy Division had like two albums and a couple of singles, yet they found like, okay, well, it's the deluxe extreme edition. Okay, it's the widescreen deluxe edition. Motley Crue does not have a lot of outtakes, does not have a lot of soundboards, but they've still found ways to keep it interesting with merchandising and tributes. And has Van Halen ever had an official tribute album? I don't think so.
No. And frankly, I would hope that they never do that. But as far as doing more with
Kiss My Ass. Do you remember that album, Kiss My Ass?
Yes, and I haven't listened to it in 20 years, but I suppose, but it could have been a bit more, it left a few things to be desired. I mean, there was some obvious ones, Garth Brooks doing Hard Luck Woman, I get that. But for its time, it was a perfect marketing move because that was at a point where, what was that, mid-90s?
Yes, 94.
Right. So at that point, there was a little bit of distance, and all those people that were getting big in the 90s, Pearl Jam, Nirvana, all these guys, they were saying two, maybe three bands that were their biggest influence because they came up with classic rock. Yes. Kiss, Aerosmith, and also Cheap Trick.
Yeah.
And people went, huh? You know, the hipster cognoscenti who tried to decipher what Eddie Vedder was mumbling went, it's not cool to like those bands. Well, fuck yeah, it is. Those first three Kiss albums are amazing. This is what, you know, this is what all these people came up with, you know, as well as the Bad Company and Led Zeppelin or whoever. But, you know, so it opened up a lot of eyes to people because previously so many of those bands were, oh, they were just 80s hair bands or they were this or that. And Van Halen was also kind of in that company to a degree. But Van Halen, in my mind, was such an untouchable degree of musical genius with Eddie. It was, you know, Stone Gossard was going to be much more influenced by Ace Frehley or Rick Nielsen or Joe Perry or whoever than he ever would have been with Eddie Van Halen. Because for every guy who could do Eruption, there was so many guys who were just like, fuck, I can't, what? Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. What's the easy song to learn? Okay, I'll learn Dance the Night Away. Okay.
Or you, their version of You Really Got Me, amped up, more energetic, you know?
So I look at it and I go, so Dave's not following the playbook of the classic rock peers. He's not following the playbook of hip hop, because if you look at how hip hop artists of today, they collaborate with a lot of other artists. In other words, they seem to do more singles and between album tracks and mixtape tracks and all that than they do studio recordings. And then they parlay the album success into the fashion line and the spirit and all that. Basically, the Sammy Hagar way of doing things. He's not doing that. He's not doing the EDM thing, which is more about like virtual worlds. I guess you could say that the Roth Project comic was a start at that, but I think he takes the first step towards all these things. It goes, nah, I'm bored. That's okay. So where I'm going with that.
And in a way I kind of dig that, I guess, from a musical standpoint. Well, I know I dig the fact that he has so many varied interests and wants to do all these different things, which is great. I just wish some more attention would be paid, or better attention would be paid, I guess, and some more discipline to the released musical output is going to be, and strategy. And because we know there's so much stuff out there, we know Dave's recording all the time, that Van Halen podcast with the insider said Dave's got so much recorded stuff.
Yes. Well, if I can piggyback, like combining two topics here, Ray Luzier, however you want to say
Luzier, sure.
He says Luzier, but
drummer extraordinaire.
If you
Ray Luzier, that rhymes.
Yo, from New Orleans, you'd probably go, it's Luzier. Right. whatever it is, he was in Dave's band for 8 years. He left on his own accord in 2005. He was on the DLR band album, the Diamond Dave album, No Holds Barbecue. He was a man about town. And there was an interview where he said that he was telling Dave, hey, we should play some of your solo stuff. And Dave said to him at that time, no one wants to hear that. What I'm getting at is Dave does not know what his fan base is craving. And you have to wonder, is that because he's not listening, or is it because he knows best? Because he knew best in 1985 and he knew best in 1988, and therefore he thinks he knows best. Because the fans of now, I would say there's kind of three camps of David Lee Roth fans. Tell me if I'm wrong about this. There's the diehards who want to hear every single thing he ever did, and that's about 5% of the fan base. There's about 75% of the people who want to hear the hits, and they're not necessarily the vocal people. And then there's the 20% of the people who go like, well, I liked him with Van Halen. And that's
I suppose you could quibble over the percentages, but to a degree, you're right. And I think it's the problem that every classic band has. I mean, I was reading a big interview in Classic Rock or Rock Candy with Joe Elliott at Def Leppard. And that their most recent album, which I have not been able to stop listening to for the better part of the summer, Diamond Star Halos, is fantastic. Proving again that classic rockers can still make good music. Yeah. And it bumps me out, put out good new original music. It bumps me out when they don't. But he said, listen, and I'm paraphrasing, but basically it's like if we played, and he was kind of poo-pooing the bands that have tried this. If we played 5 or 6 songs from Diamond Star Halos during the stadium, you know, we'd have half the people leaving. People would be pissed off. You have to run what brought you to the dance, man. You get what I'm saying? I mean, there's no way Dave could do 7 or 8 solo songs in, say, a 16 song set, right? Or whatever, a 15, 8, whatever it might be, whether he's opening for Kiss or whether or not he's doing a full thing. But that's why I so applauded him when he did Big Train.
Yeah.
I would have bet everything that, oh my God, we'll be lucky if we hear Just a Gigolo and California Girls. That's probably going to be it from his solo stuff when he's opening for Kiss. Right? It wasn't the case.
I think he did 4 or 5 solo songs in general, but not 8, not 2.
Right, right. So I think what I'm getting at is that there is some sort, you know, as far as when it's playing live, as far as giving the people what do they want, 75% of those people out there want the hits, the Van Halen hits especially. So, I mean, I go back to with the Sammy tour. I mean, those were Dave fans that were there. If you put 5 or 6, 7, if you made half and half, and this is 2002, if you did half and half solo, half Van Halen, I don't think anybody would have complained.
Right. I think that those
Sammy's doing that was at the time.
Yeah. Sammy has become more Van Halen over the years with his live show. I think on that O2 tour, it was half and half, whereas Dave was like 90% Van Halen. And then each tour, he would drop 1 or 2 more Van Halen deep cuts and then go a little more solo. Like I don't think that he was doing California Girls on the O2 tour. He was doing Yankee Rose. And I don't think he was doing Just Like Paradise.
I'm pretty sure you're right on that.
Yeah. So you fast forward a couple of years. I remember when I saw him, the next year in 03, he did Going Crazy, Yankee Rose, Just Like Paradise, Just a Gigolo, that's 4. I think he did 4 or 5 solo tracks. Oh, Shoebop, if you want to call that a solo track. Well, he changes over time, but I don't know. Like, we never question intellect. We never question the talent. We just are questioning the judgment and whether or not he's listening to anybody. And I don't think he's listening to anybody. So he's in such a crazy vacuum that goes, you know, the best way to address this, is it performing at the Taylor Hawkins concert that they would definitely have me perform at because they performed live with the Foo Fighters in 2015. And I was definitely invited to do that. No, the best idea would be to counter blast this with a studio re-record of a Van Halen song. Insane.
It's odd because I'm the same person as say silence can sometimes be golden in a great marketing campaign, but part of a good marketing campaign, right? But at the same time, doing weird stuff like this, you know, we're asking for music and we're asking for statements, and then we get this. You know what bugged me also about the statement is that it had to mention it's all live and it's Van Halen free.
Yes. That
bugged the shit out of me.
That bothers me so much because I thought, hey, thinking of you, Ed, wait, which one is it?
I mean, first,
me and Alex talk like we laugh like pirates every day on the phone.
First off, I get it. If it's David Lee Roth doing a cover, no one's going to mistake it for Van Halen unless you say it's a Van Halen song. But if you say David Lee Roth released a new version of, right? And you can easily reword the statement from Major Dozier. It's all live and feature. All you need to say it's all Dave, all live with Al Estrada guitar, Ryan Woolley, that Van. You don't have to say it's Van Halen free. And then they list the names of who are on the song in the statement. You get what I'm saying? You just didn't have to say that. And maybe somewhere went. I doubt this, but the only reason why I could think you say that is like, well, for SEO purposes, you know what? You get Van Halen there. That's a keyword that could help drive some clicks. But that's not their freaking. You know what I'm saying? I don't think that's their goal anyway.
The only alternate theory as to why this came out that I can come up with, which a lot of artists of Dave generation have done, this is the only alternate thing, and I will dispute why. I'll unprove my theory in the same sentence. The only thing that I can think of is he re-recorded the Van Halen catalog for film and TV and video game pitching purposes. Like, hey, we want Van Halen. We've got 150K. Oh, that's not going to cut it. But I'll tell you what, I got mine for 80K. That happened with Squeeze. That happened with ELO. So many classic artists have re-recorded their catalog as a way of going, well, the next time you want it, buy our version instead.
Yeah, Kiss did the re-recorded classics, the second disc for the Sonic Boom record.
I've heard rumors that there's Queen re-records. I don't know how possible that is, but a lot of your favorite artists have sound-alike versions of their hits that they own, that they did on their own dime. And usually you can tell it because, like, in the movie The Wrestler, like, you hear Rat in the background, and those are Stephen Piercy re-records as opposed to Rat.
And is it really? I didn't know that.
Yeah, you could kind of tell because the vocals will be a little bit fuzzy or the mix will be, but it's like to the average ear, you'd be like, oh, cool, Rat.
Well,
like,
and for a 30-second bit in a movie, I get it, sure.
So there's a chance that Dave did it for this reason, because Van Halen has turned down a lot of things over the years. This is just guessing. They've probably said yes to 10% of the things that they've been offered. It's like, not enough money, pass.
Or they don't even reply at all.
yeah, there was
you a hear nothing. Suit
in Guns N' Roses where they wanted to use Welcome to the Jungle. It was either Paradise City or Welcome to the Jungle for $1 million for the movie Old School. And Axl turned it down, and other members of the band sued Axl. And I think that kind of bled into the reunion of like, you're not going to screw up our money here. We're united against you. And sometimes you'll see like that happen with the Misfits, where Jerry and Glenn were suing each other. And part of the settlement was you have to do Misfits reunion gigs. That sounds like a Seinfeld preference. Seinfeld premise, rather. by me suing you, we have to work together. There's a chance that that's what this is, but I have a feeling that Van Halen would throw that venom back at them and be like, we're not going to prove it if it's the re-record.
It's always fun and easy to speculate.
But you know what? I think I'm right on this one. You can drop the niceness and go,
no,
you're right.
none of this doesn't make sense. These all are it's all possibilities, right? With it, for lack of any other info or knowledge, even before I read the announcement on Van Halen news desk, when I saw like a clip of it or saw a couple links, or whatever, I'm like, oh shit, they actually put those words with the release. there's a sentence or two around this. Wow, all right, that's a victory.
And unfortunately for me, like, this overshadows how amazing Wolfgang was, how watching him and Justin Hawkins do Van Halen in an original, yet like they're not trying to be Van Halen, yet it comes across as a tribute and fun and authentic. To me, this overshadows. It's a dark cloud over the David Lee Roth legacy.
I think it only overshadows. Yeah, I mean, only overshadows a little bit, I think, for us hardcore fans. I mean, when that Wolfgang performance, I mean, Wolfgang was there because Taylor loved Van Halen.
Yeah,
I'm assuming they knew each other. Nobody had a bad word to say about Taylor, and you could just tell the joy in performing those songs up there. It just really showed through.
The only way I'm going to eat my words on all this ways. One is getting a cease and desist from the David Lee Roth organization, which isn't going to happen because he doesn't talk to anyone, apparently. The other one is the Taylor Hawkins show that's going to be in LA at the Forum, which is a much smaller show. Maybe we do see Dave on that one and he just didn't want to travel overseas. Maybe his team didn't do his passport on time. Is that a possibility, Steve? They forgot.
I'll tell you right now. There's one thing you can rely on, the fact that guy's passport never expires. Him being a world traveler, he gets that done. I guarantee you.
EMT license expired.
Well, but he didn't want to be an EMT anymore. If he goes, I'm not going to travel anymore because of COVID or whatever, the guy just got back from Mexico. So it is up to, I'm telling you, it's up to date.
Okay, let me say it this way. some of his business registrations, not just the trademarks, have expired. There's a lot of lapsing going on in David Lee Roth land. So there could always be the, I don't feel like getting an emergency passport. I'll do the LA show.
Yeah.
Well, conspiracy theory Darren over here, you know, his mind has been pretty occupied. But the other update is Sammy Hagar, that interview offer that keeps getting rescinded and reoffered.
The ongoing saga of the Sammy interview.
It got off two more times since that podcast was taped. And I finally said, well, I can email questions. How many? And they said between 6 and 10. So I sent, I think, 9 questions over. And they didn't say, okay, received. I'm gonna give it another week or so to see if the Q&A with Sammy is happening.
Well, if there's a Q&A, we'll, if there's an email Q&A, you'll read it here on the DLR cast.
If I were a betting man, I would bet he answers the first 4 questions and skips the last 4 to 5.
Are the last 4 to 5 Van Halen related?
They are. But positive Van Halen related, except for one of them, which asks if a particular rumor or two is true related to his O2 tour.
Okay. On that, we'll leave it at that.
So that's the Dave recap. That's the Wolfgang recap. That's kind of the me and Sammy saga recap. We got a, an accidental shout out on the Unchained podcast, by the way.
Oh, nice.
I was tipped off this by our former guest, Gary from Boston.
Yes.
And he said, hey, did you hear you were mentioned on there? I went, nope. Tune into 1 minute. 1 hour, 9 minutes in, when some listener of theirs, Midwestern Ronnie, Midwestern something like that, he asked this whole question about the Deep Throat episode. And one of his questions is, and do you guys listen to the DLR cast? And they skipped that part of the question. So,
all right. Well, and you know what? On that, I've been totally neglectful. I have a meaning. Shout out to Gary for sending me 2 awesome CDs after his appearance here. I got him now, geez, about 2 months, a month ago at least, and I've neglected to send him an email via Facebook. But he sent me a really cool CD, The World Gone Crazy on the Road with New England's premier comedy band, of which Gary is a member of. And then he sent me this wild Van Halen sort of rarities thing, The Trouble with Never, 1985. And it's got Ripley Going Crazy, Best of Both Worlds, California Girls, Miwise Magic. It's got a bunch of, it's cool. I don't know where he got this stuff, that Van Halen. It's good stuff. So thank you, Gary.
Gary knows. I say Gary from Boston like the WFAN, like, Gary from Boston, you're on the line.
Talking Red Sox, Gary from Boston.
Yeah, so I think we're in the same predicament that we've been in previous episodes, where it's like we don't know if something big is going to come tomorrow or never or in a month. And it's interesting and exciting and frustrating all at the same time.
All right, let's put it down here. Call it a bet, call it what you will, just a prediction. I don't even want to try to predict when it might happen, but what do you think the next piece of music release from Dave is going to be? Is it going to be something from the John 5 sessions, or do you think it'll be another one from May 22, the Henson recording studio session, another Van Halen cover with his current band?
I'm going to say the opposite. I'm going to say we don't get anything within the next 2 months unless Wolfgang appears at the LA show and Dave doesn't.
I wonder, what's interesting about that. I wonder who, I mean, certainly like Liam Gallagher showed up, right? I mean, so there was clearly, I'm wondering if there'll be any overlap of some of the artists that were on the Wembley one. When is the LA one?
That, let me Google that. I should know that offhand. Taylor Hawkins, LA concert, 2022. September 27th. So that is 3 weeks ish from now at the Kia Forum in Inglewood. That is the forum, the really small one where Dave Grohl did the birthday concert, right?
Right.
wow, I'm so surprised they'd be doing a small concert like that, unless it's like a sweetheart renting deal, or because it's Irving Azoff and his team working on that venue, that it's like, yeah, film whatever you want here. Whereas the Staples Center would be like, no, can't film it. Like, isn't that such a small venue for all these legends?
Perhaps. I mean, can they fill the whatever the Enormo Dome is where the Rams play now?
Yes,
they probably.
If they filled
that Wembley, yeah.
And then there's always the old music industry trick of you push the stage up, and then you tarp all the areas behind the stage into the side of the stage, and then you tarp this one out of view. They could do that. I think that the Foo Fighters are like the biggest classic rock band in the world. Like, when I say classic rock band, it's like Roger Waters level in terms of the number of tickets that they can sell. It's just a different audience and a different like promotional plan. Roger Waters sells a lot of tickets. It's kind of off the radar. Like, if Roger Waters does Madison Square Garden, that's an underplay. He could sell a lot more tickets than that. It's just, you don't really realize. Like, Pink Floyd is one of those bands who people who don't really like music or concerts love Pink Floyd and Roger Waters. So he could sell out stadiums everywhere, and he could do two nights. And you just don't know, because you don't have any friends who are Roger Waters fans.
No, I do not.
But when I was like walking around Madison Square Garden last week, and there was the Roger Waters concert, and you saw the number of Pink Floyd t-shirts walking at you, you go, oh, there are a lot of these fans out there. Cool. You know, Harry Styles, I think, has 15 gigs at Madison Square Garden. Please tell me that's not on your radar.
It's not. Being in the Midwest here, I'll tell you what is on my radar, though, is the fact that is Billy Joel still doing his once a month?
Yeah.
Take the helicopter from Montauk into New York and do a gig at Madison Square Garden once a month?
Yeah, usually with a special guest in the show.
Doing an encore, right? Yeah. So.
Yeah. So there's a lot of stuff happening in the touring industry. And I also think it's foolish of Dave in this era, unless he's very sick, which he's never said in any way that he's sick. It's always the outsiders. He really is missing out in not trying to be part of the conversation as a live performing artist. And there's so many things that he could be doing. He doesn't have to do a 90-minute show. He could be a special guest that does three songs every night on a tour, the way that Guns N' Roses would bring out Izzy Stradlin to do two, three songs every night in the middle of their Enormo Dome stadium tour. Dave could be doing something if he wanted to be doing it. He could be recording for a major label album. He could be doing box sets. He could be putting out reissues, but instead...
he wants to do other things. And God bless him.
Other things. And I hope he pops up for the Taylor Hawkins tribute show.
I mean, certainly at that... I've watched that Grohl birthday video all the time, and the crowd went ape shit. You could tell the band absolutely, Taylor, everybody was just like sitting there, mouths agog and big smiles on their face with Dave up there. And he sounded great when they did Panama.
Yeah.
And it certainly would make sense to, I don't think he'll be up there.
Oh, I would say 50-50 shot that he's doing this because he saw Wolfgang on that and goes, I am Van Halen. You remember that quote from that?
Yes, another cringeworthy moment. Wouldn't it be cool? And I don't think this happens at all, but I'll be more than willing and happy to give a public mea culpa once again. How cool would it be if Dave and Wolfgang were up there and they were doing Van Halen in LA at the Taylor Hawkins tribute concert? That would be the best of everything, and smiles all around, and no bullshit, and Dave Grohl's playing bass, and it's just killer. I don't think it's going to happen. And it's probably not going to happen now after you just dropped Panama on this with saying Van Halen free in the section in the public statement. But how doesn't that make perfect sense? You did Panama there before.
Yeah.
Grohl and company loves you. Taylor loved you and Van Halen.
I think that Wolfie is yet another example of the offspring of the rock legend being as good as, I'm not going to say it better than, but as good as the parent that spawned them. And we see that in Cheap Trick, where Rick Nielsen's kid is
Dax is
as good
and sturdy ass drummer and Robin's son. Yeah. I mean, I'll tell you what, I think it's interesting to note that nobody's speculating or wondering if Wolfie's going to get up there or if Sammy's going to get up there to do Why Can't This Be Love or Pound Cake at a Taylor Hawkins tribute concert.
Well, have you seen that video with the Taylor Hawkins con? It's an outdoor festival from somewhere in an LA beach town. And it's a whole set of Taylor Hawkins singing lead with Josh Freese and a couple of the people from the Coattail Riders. It's an all pre-1985 Van Halen set with Taylor Hawkins singing.
Yeah, and you just reminded me, I have one of the Coattail Riders albums, and he had his classic rock bona fides. I mean, he it's a fun record, and he was he could sing. There's a great on Letterman several years ago, Foo Fighters were on.
Yes.
And Rick Nielsen played guitar, and they did Stiff Competition, and Taylor Hawkins sung lead and wore the classic white suit that Xander wore back in the 70s. And they did Stiff Competition from Cheap Trick's third album, Heaven Tonight, which was that was like, what? How cool is that? I mean, the majority of that audience went, what the fuck is this?
Yeah.
But a vocal minority went, this is amazing. And they're paying homage and they love it. Maybe Sammy gets up there and does I Can't Drive 55. Maybe Taylor loved that song. Wouldn't surprise me if he did. Millions do.
I think that kudos really, really go to Grohl and team for producing what may have been the best, my words, not yours, may have been the best tribute concert of all time, or at least on par with the Freddie Mercury one, in that you got a Beatle up there. You got a member of Led Zeppelin. You got Queen. You got Liam Gallagher. Yet Kesha, you know, Wolfgang, you did get some younger people and some modern radio people besides the classic rock gods, besides the peers of the Foo Fighters. It was such uniting, positive, wonderful, multi-generational occasion. We still don't know what's going to come from LA. I think Gene Simmons is on that. That'll be interesting to see what happens in that one.
Do you do just Gene? Because again, I go back to the fact that on Dave's birthday party, they did, was it Detroit Rock City? When Paul came up there, and wouldn't it be great if Paul and Gene were both up there?
Never say never on that end, but maybe Paul and Gene don't want to be next to each other anymore. They have to be.
I don't know. I mean, I saw a fun, there was a couple of weeks back, there was a documentary. There was a really cool thing making the rounds from Australia, 60 Minutes.
Yeah.
Because they were just down there and they're a happy bunch in their luxury jet. And Gene and Paul were intermingling with each other and laughing. They were together on the jet and it just seemed natural. I really believe that those two, I mean, I don't think it's a thing where they're not talking to each other all week or every day before the show. Do you know what I mean? It just seems to me that these, they don't hate each other.
Yeah, they do. There's a clip to find. I think it's 1993.
Okay, but that was 93. I know what clip you're talking about. I'm talking about right now, today, when the end is coming.
Stop the tape. Will you stop cutting me down?
Yes.
Will you stop?
I get it. And no, and that's, yes. And back then, yes. But I'm saying right now, today.
Yeah.
I'm just saying there's some harmony there. You know what I'm saying? There's a united front.
Yeah.
And you know, they're not doing co-interviews together anymore, but they haven't in a long time. But
have you seen the clips of their Kiss is sound checking? I got to cut you off. They're doing their, you know, you have to pay this much to watch them sound check or this much to watch them play acoustic backs.
And Gene shows up in the hotel bathrobe. That one?
Oh, that's another goodie. The Gene reprimanding Paul in front of the audience. Save your voice.
I did not see that one.
Oh, yeah, because Paul starts. He's doing the window washing up for those not seeing video, where you like the Christina Aguilera that, and she's save your voice. And he reprimands him a number of times. Like there's a super cut of that you can find.
See, I try to stay away from those cringeworthy moments. There's enough negativity in the world. Call me the happy go lucky positive guy. You know, we'll be the yin and yang of the podcast here.
I'll take that any day. That's fine. But I think that we have a uniting rock and roll thing. And if there's anybody who could have gotten Eddie and Dave back together again, I think it would have been Dave Grohl, based on that Led Zeppelin reunion that he got to happen at that Wembley show in 2012, 2013. Do you remember that encore where John Paul Jones, Jimmy Page come on, and yeah, then Taylor and Dave doing rock and roll? I think that Grohl is one of the last uniting people in rock, regardless of how much you love the Foo Fighters catalog. And we may see some interesting things at this LA show.
Here's hoping.
I don't think we'll see a Pink Floyd reunion. I think that ship has sailed.
No, I mean, that's the equivalent of, to paraphrase a pun here, given Roger Waters' political stance, that's like uniting the Palestinians and the Israelis, for God's sake. So Gilmore and Waters, that's not going to happen.
That happened at the Live 8 concert that Bob Geldof did in like 04, 05.
Right, right.
And then they came out and they said, all of our royalties go to charity. And then I don't think they could talk ever again. And, you know, forever the difficulties there. But I really think that if anybody could get Wolfgang and Dave on the same stage, or Alex and Dave on the same stage, it is Grohl. There's nobody else I see.
No.
Do it.
He's the great equalizer and the great, you know what word I'm looking for. I'm losing words.
You're losing words because I've just blinded you with science. But I really do hope that we get positive news in some form soon. And that positive news is not Dave singing a Van Halen song that he recorded in May.
And on that note, if there is, we'll report it within a week's time.
We will. So thank you for bearing.
Schedules allow.
With the conspiracy theories, and thank you to Steve for working on Labor Day.
Oh, please.
And thanks to Wolfgang for making us believe in rock.
Yes. Hear, hear.